nothing worthwhile. The recognized symbol of excellence in crappy podcasting.
Hi, I'm Evan Moody, man.
Andy Guthrie, man. What's going on?
And you're listening to Nothing Worthwhile.
And you're listening to Nothing with Groo and the thing there.
Of course, I prefer atonal jazz, but... Oh, hi. We're with Brent Mydland, the keyboard player for the Grateful Dead. Brent, I suppose you get tired of being asked what it's like to be the new member of the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, I'm getting real burned out on the new guy image.
Yeah. So, Brent, what's it like being the new member of the Grateful Dead?
A lot of people asking me what it's like being the Grateful Dead.
Uh-huh. Well, Brent, was there any initiation you had to go through?
They locked me in a room for 14 days with a strobe light.
Mm. Good thing you weren't an epileptic. Now, has there been any member of the band who's been a particular prick to you?
Actually, Weir has. He keeps snapping me with a towel in the locker room.
Ouch. Well, who's been the nicest guy?
Definitely Phil.
Phil, huh? Okay, now, Brent, did you have any problems learning any of the Dead's tunes?
No, actually, I picked them up pretty easy. I have had a problem with one tune.
Now, what's that?
St. Stephen.
St. Stephen? That's odd. It doesn't seem like a particularly complex tune. I'm not a musician, but why don't you play it for us?
Wouldn't you rather hear Far From Me or Easy to Love You?
Well, no, we haven't really heard St. Stephen for a while, so why don't you...
That's because I can't play it.
Well, why don't you just give it a shot for us, huh?
You asked for it.
Okay. St. Stephen.
Shit. Fuck.
Well, how about this note?
Won't work.
Why don't you just give it a try, Brent? Just give it a try.
If you really want me to.
Yeah. Try that note.
Told you.
Hey, this is really great, Tom. This is really terrific. We're going to go out in front of a Grateful Dead audience, and none of the Dead will introduce us. That's just terrific. They're going to eat us up. They're going to be going, who the
really
fuck are these
thirsty.
Guys, you know?
I know. I don't know.
I'm thirsty, too.
Hey, excuse me. Would you go out and get a couple of cold sixes, because I'm going to go on stage, and I'm getting really dry.
Oh, I would, but I got to go up there myself pretty soon. I'm the keyboard player.
Oh, Brent, I'm sorry. Hey, you know, your songs on latest album are the best.
They're a breath of fresh air, let me tell you.
Yeah.
Something different, finally.
Really?
Brent, we were wondering if you'd do us a kind of a favor, if you'd introduce us tonight.
Ooh, that's a good idea.
Yeah. To the audience?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You know, help us out a lot.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thanks.
Frank and Dave.
No, Brent. It's Franken and Davis, okay?
Franken and Davis.
Oh, yeah. I got it.
All right.
Okay.
Great.
Okay, well, we're going to go on now, so let's go.
Yeah.
Hey, wait a minute. Brent, okay. Main thing is just tell the crowd that we've been friends of the Dead for a long, long time. You know, like a lot longer than you have.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. Say, like, you know, we were there for the acid test with Ken Kesley and Mary Munsters and, you know, Montana will pay us and stuff like that. Yeah. All right?
Fine.
Lay it on thick.
Okay,
let's go. This is going to be fun.
Oh, this is going to be great.
Thanks, Brent.
Got it. We need this. Okay, you're doing, this is a big favor for us, Brent. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to be going out there in front of all those dead heads, and it's like, Jerry, Dark Star.
Yeah,
we got to do comedy in front of these guys, so, you know.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, go out there. Now, remember, sure. We're friends of the Dead for a long time. Oh, this is great, Tom. This is great. We're going out in front of the dead audience, and we're going to be introduced by Brent. And he's been with the group for about 5 minutes. This is just great. This is just great. Come on, let's go. He must be out there.
Sorry to have to do this. I don't really know these guys, and I don't think they're very funny. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Frank and Dave.
sexual owners haven't even been born yet. But we never tend the garden and we rarely pay the rent. Most of it is broken and the rest of it is bent. Put it all on plastic and I wonder where we'll be when the bill's here. We can't run, but we can't hide from it. Of all possible worlds, we only got one, we gotta ride on it. Whatever we've done, we'll never get far from what we leave behind. Baby, we can run, 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 but we can't hide. Well, I'm dumping my trash in your backyard, making certain you don't notice really isn't so hard. You're still busy with your guns and all of your excuses to use them. Well, it's oil for the rich and babies for the poor. We got everyone believing that more is more. When a reckoning comes, maybe we'll know what to do then. We can't run, but we can't hide from it. Of all possible worlds, we only got one, we gotta ride on it. Whatever we've done, we'll never get far from what we leave behind. Baby, we can run, 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 but we can't hide. Oh no, we can't hide. All these complications seem to leave no choice. I heard the tongues of billions speak with just one voice, saying just leave all the rest to me. I need it worse than you, you see. And then I heard the sound of one child cry. The light pours in.
Where is it now?
Now I'm down on the asphalt land, like a hammer and blow from God's left hand. But that's something we can't do.
Of all possible worlds, we've only got one, we gotta ride.
We gotta ride on me and you.
Yeah, we'll never get far.
We'll never get far. No, we'll never get far.
Maybe we can run, run.
Maybe we
run.
Can, maybe we can yeah, run. Run. But we can't.
We can't hide from it.
No, we can't hide from it.
Of all possible worlds, we only know.
Whatever we've done, we'll never get far from what we leave behind. Baby, we can run, 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 but we can't hide.
Yes, we are back live via Zoom. It's been a while.
It has.
America's number one. Yes, America's number one bicoastal podcast featuring two annoying Jews. My name, Evan Moody. I'm on the West Coast in the much colder state of Arizona. Temperatures have dropped well into the 40s in the early morning hours. Yeah, it's cold. It's cold.
Wow.
I actually had to put the heat on. I had to put the heat on downstairs, and then upstairs we have a little portable heater that we like to
use. Ooh, a little portable heater.
Yeah.
A little space heater. Have a good time. Yeah.
We're specifically in the great city of Phoenix, Arizona, along with show mascot. Andrew got a chance to take a viewing a little bit earlier with his Journey t-shirt on, Braxton Moody, a.k.a. Doggy Shango.
Doggy Shango.
Doggy Shango. Yeah, he's beyond the puppy.
He's growing, huh?
Now. He's growing. He's sleeping on the floor, enjoying.
So can we call
the,
him? Can we call him? Can we call him Matilda?
Oh, please, no! No, but the treacherous fate of the British Bulldogs.
Yeah.
That'll be a pass. Actually, Bulldogs—they're not a very healthy breed. They got all those skin folds, and everyone, even Howard, talked about.
I don't know much about. I don't. I'm not an.
Yeah, I know. You're focused on you and only you, and actually, good for you.
Only me.
So let me introduce my good friend. He's in the southeast part of the United States, specifically Coral Springs or Parkland, Florida. His name is Andrew Gruthius, annoying Jew number two. Groo, how the hell are you, my friend?
I'm doing just fine. It's good to see you again, as always, for the first time, for the last time.
Thank you.
What? Oh yeah, this is like our last show for the year.
It is
Thursday, December 30th.
Yes, a rare Thursday tape.
Yes, a rare Thursday taping of Nothing Worthwhile. Yes, everything here is fine. Although the weather is, I mean, it's been gorgeous. Like,
screw you.
I'm surprised that it's so cold down there. It's like, it's been absolutely perfect here. Normally, I like it when it rains during the vacation because then I can justify staying inside and doing nothing. And I like it to, you know, I like to stick it to all the people who come down to Florida, you know, and pretend they own the place for 2 weeks. And then they bring their COVID down here and then they go back to New York. But everything is... Everything's
yes. It's all an evil conspiracy.
Of course, it's an evil conspiracy. Yeah. You've got the blue state bringing their stuff to the red state. You know, they're the enemy. We have to destroy them. There's just no other way.
Of course, Andrew has to wedge in his political commentary even on a fun. Anyway,
everything down here is great. We're gearing up towards the towards New Year's, and moving on to bigger and better and happier and healthier times in 2022. Any resolutions for you, Evan?
Ooh, I haven't really thought about that much. I'll take a pass on that. I haven't really thought about it, to be honest with you. I just hope, just like you. Hope for a happy, healthy new year, a productive year.
Good.
Another year on the face of this earth.
Yeah.
So, any plans for New Year's Eve?
Yes. My plan is, and don't get upset, don't get angry, but I'm not planning on leaving the house on New Year's Eve because, as you know, New Year's Eve is when Cobra Kai season 4 is dropping.
Well, so why would I be angry?
That's
about
my
that?
No. No, I'm just.
I'm looking forward to
no,
it too.
But that's all how right. That's how I'm spending New Year's. I'm glued to the TV. So that's my New Year's plans. There's nothing really going on around here. Like people are actually surprisingly they're hunkering down a little bit again because of this new wave that's coming through. But it probably wouldn't change anything for me. I'd still be doing the exact same thing. But in 22, you know, I'm looking, you know, I've got some resolutions. I'm looking to start smoking. I'm looking to, you know, to put on another, you know, 30 or 40 pounds. I want to be constructive. I want to build. I don't want to take away. I want to build. So, you know, I'm going to add a lot of sugar. And, I can't really add much more than I already take, but, you know. I want to do things that are constructive. So, yes, we're going to...
Since you always mentioned COVID and the pandemic, I mean, if it really wipes everything out, Angie said he wants to build his fat reserves, his sugar reserves.
Yes.
You know, if
yes, you got to be protected.
Goes completely down. There you go.
You got to be protected. You know, no one will ever argue that one. But, yeah.
Well, we wish everyone listening a very, very happy and healthy New Year. Probably be the same. We may go to her Marie's brother's for if we go, we'll probably stay over there. I'm not going to be on the road.
Yeah, you sound like thrilled.
Huh?
You sound thrilled. Yeah, we'll go.
No, I love my I love her brother. I don't know if I'll watch Cobra Kai then.
What's Pop's Moody doing on New Year's?
Probably a bottle of red, six bottles of white. Then he'll call me and be like, "I screwed up. I needed a ride. I had to get the Uber. There's this thing called Uber." just a mess.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, he called me yesterday. And, this is probably not interesting to anyone, but I'm sure Andy might find it interesting. So he goes. So my dad got me for my 30th birthday, very generous. He got me a Rolex watch, and he had it like encrypted. And Rolexes
encrypted?
Are pretty. I'm sorry, engraved. He had it engraved. He had like my name
encrypted. There's like
the
secret nuclear codes in there.
All right. I'm vamping for content. So he put like my name and maybe like my date of birth on the back of the watch. Very, very right. Beautiful gift. But with like Rolexes, they're pretty complicated. You got to like actually take them in once a year and get them cleaned,
yeah.
And get them like reworked. And you know, like I'm lazy, so my dad and I never wear it because I'm not a big jewelry guy. Like I like a watch. That's about it. I don't wear bracelets.
I remember your earring phase.
Okay, yeah, but I was half gay then. I've completely fallen out of that. I've completely fallen out of that era. But yeah. Anyway, well, you know, you get a job, you become a teacher, you're professional. It's in that whole era, that kind of phased out anyway, for me anyway. So my dad, I said, "Dad, look, take the watch." You know, he wears it, he has it, and then he's like, "I was on a website yesterday looking at Rolexes, and I looked at our model. Do you know how much money that Rolex is worth?" And I'm like, "No." And he's like, "I saw an estimate for $13,000. I was like,
yes!
I was like,
celebrate good times. Come on!
I'm like, Groo, get over here. We're going to the highlighter quickly.
Yeah, but then when they see Evan Moody, it goes down to 75 cents.
Exactly.
It's like, yes, I want to get this autograph from Babe Ruth or something. And the only problem is it says, like, to Harold.
You know? right. There you go. So, yeah, everybody's good. I had dinner. We met my brother out went to the Cheesecake Factory and had a nice little dinner. Marie and I, we saw Andrew. He's in good spirits. He's starting a new job.
Yes.
The beginning of the new year, so we're really excited for him. And
great.
Mom's Moody is doing well, and who cares? All right, everybody's fine. Groo, on today's podcast, Groo, Rolling Stone magazine calls them the greatest jam band of all time. It's the Grateful Dead, but we're going to specifically focusing on the Brett Mydland era of the Grateful Dead. It's Mydland and the Dead But before we get to that, Andrew, we're gonna test run our newest game. We're gonna test run something called Stump the Grooey. Are you ready, Andrew?
You're gonna test me?
Yeah, I gotta get to my stopwatch here.
Is this like Stump the Buoy?
We are riffing off of.
No. I'm just saying, just so I know what to do, because this is a test run.
This is a test run, so
I got to make a jingle if it works.
Well, yes, these are questions that any member of the Nothing Worthwhile universe could answer. These are trivia questions on music, movies, television, pro wrestling trivia, and Howard Stern, all 80s on.
Okay.
You want to give it a shot?
I do. So what? So you.
I will.
Go ahead.
I'll read you the question. You give me the answer, or you could say pass, and I'll go to the next question, and then I'll go back, and we'll see how long it takes you. We'll just try this for fun.
Right. So, basically, the idea is if I was playing against somebody, they wouldn't hear my answers, and
that's correct.
And whoever gets more in less time is the winner.
That would be correct.
Okay. All right. I'm looking forward to this. Yes. Yes.
All right.
Let me play something. There we go. Okay.
All right. Our newest game. Yeah. Stump the Grooey. All right. Yeah. All right. Here we go. All right. We're going to start the clock.
All right.
In 3, 2, 1.
Okay.
Name the first Billy Joel album to be produced by Phil Ramone.
The Stranger.
Sylvester Stallone. Tango. Full name.
Ray Tango.
Who played Bobby Ewing on the hit show Dallas?
Patrick Duffy.
Who did Ric Flair defeat to win the first NWA title?
Dusty Rhodes.
What was the first city to syndicate Howard Stern outside of New York?
Philadelphia.
When Springsteen won a Tony Award, who presented it to him?
Oh. Pass. Wow.
The original host of WWF's Tuesday Night Titans.
Vince McMahon.
And?
Lord Alfred Hayes.
Whom did John Cena beat for his last WWE championship?
Oh, God. I'm going to say Randy Orton.
Name the Van Halen album with the most sales all time.
It's got to be 1984.
What was the name of the film where Robert De Niro played a concerned father trying to keep his son away from the local crime boss?
A Bronx Tale.
When Springsteen won a Tony Award, who presented it to
you? You asked me that. Oh, we're going back to it. I know it's wrong, but I'm going to say Robert De Niro.
And do you want to go back to who did John Cena beat for his last WWE championship?
You're saying I got it wrong.
That's right.
I'll say The Miz.
All right, we'll stop there.
Okay.
All right. Let's go through this. I apologize. I should have said those two were wrong.
No, it's okay.
Name the first Billy. We'll work on this. Name the first Billy Joel album to be produced by Phil Ramone. Andrew said The Stranger. That is correct.
Nice.
Sylvester Stallone's Tango. Full name Ray or Raymond Tango. That is correct. Who played Bobby Ewing on the hit show Dallas? Andrew said Patrick Duffy. That is correct. Whom did Ric Flair defeat to win his first NWA title? Andrew was correct. Dusty Rhodes.
Nice.
That would be September 17th, 1981.
That part I wouldn't have gotten.
What was the first city or first major city to syndicate Howard Stern outside of New York? Philadelphia. Andrew was correct. September 18th, 1996.
No.
Okay.
That can't be 96. Had to be 86 because I was thinking about DiBella.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I think that was wrong. All right, fuck off. Sorry.
No, because the funeral for DiBella was way before that, I think. Way before 96.
When Springsteen won a Tony Award, which is the Oscar of theater, who presented it to him on the Tony Awards? It was one Billy Joel.
Really? I don't remember that.
Yes.
I remember De Niro introduced him performing on the Tony Awards. But I couldn't remember that it was Billy Joel who presented him with the award.
That's what I got.
No. You're right. I'm sure you're right. I'm just saying, De Niro introduced him, Bruce performing one of his songs, but he didn't present them with any award. That's why I said De Niro.
Who are the original hosts of the WWF's Tuesday Night Titans? Andrew said Vince McMahon and Lord Alfred Hayes. He was correct. Whom did John Cena beat for his last WWE Championship? Groo originally said Randy Orton, which is a good guess, but actually I have The Rock at WrestleMania 29 in New York was Cena's last WWE Championship. Name the Van Halen album with the most sales. Van Halen 1984 was correct. And the name of the film in which Robert De Niro plays a concerned dad trying to keep his son away from the local crime boss, local mob. Andrew said A Bronx Tale. That was correct. We wrapped it up in, let me just unlock my screen, 1 minute and 39 seconds.
So that's 8 out of 10?
Was that? You got 8 out of 10.
8 out of 10. Not bad.
Yeah, was that enjoyable in any way?
Yes. No, but I really enjoy it, and I love answering questions. And I think if we do the thing where we bring somebody on to compete, you know, to do it right.
What was that? It sounded
No, I knocked my iced coffee over, but nothing spilled. Thank God.
All right.
Yeah. No. I like that. I like that.
All right. Well, if anyone's listening and wants to challenge Mr. Andrew Gruthius at Stump the Grooey, we'll put a little message out on our Facebook page, and you'll message us, and we'll have you come on sometime in 2022.
Bring it, Mike Levy. Bring it, Mike Levy.
He'd be a good candidate.
He would. Perhaps
Craig Asselbein. Mike Levy would be good. Mike Levy, I think, would be a perfect candidate, actually, for Stump the Grooey. All right.
Craig will be.
Andrew, perhaps. Give yourself credit. Those were medium. I didn't want to go too hard.
I'm surprised I didn't get the Cena one, but I didn't. I'd forgotten that that match was for the title. I'd forgotten about that.
Yeah, and actually, it's been a while. He really, after that second Rock WrestleMania tilt, they kind of. I won't say they brought. They, I mean, he definitely had a couple of runs with the. What is it? Not the Intercontinental, the United States Championship.
Right.
Remember, he had the on Raw, the United States Open Challenge. You know what? This is a good segue, real quick, Andrew. Day one pay per view WWE will be Saturday, actually.
Yep.
We texted quite a bit yesterday. I know that you are looking forward to it. Real quick, let me give quick thoughts. Obviously, the main event for the Universal Championship, Roman Reigns versus Brock Lesnar. You want to put a prediction on wax right now? Tell us what you think.
Think Brock Lesnar's going to win this one, and I think they're pretty much going to go back and forth until WrestleMania, where obviously they're going to have that's going to be the main event again. I'm not that terribly excited about it, only because we've seen it several times. But I think that will be the end of this run.
I agree.
But I think Brock is going to win. I think Brock is going to win on day one, though.
Okay, thank you. Now I will please pause, and I will. I actually agree with you. I think that the time to put the belt on Brock is now. Obviously, there you got the whole Paul Heyman angle, and I actually agree with you about WrestleMania. Like, I'm okay with it, but I'm just okay with it.
Yeah.
We've seen these guys tangle enough. Would I be really excited if they did something up to WrestleMania and perhaps split those guys up into, you know, that would be intriguing, but I'm pretty sure Andrew's right. You'll probably see this go all the way through WrestleMania, and that will close the story. And, you know, look, I can't kill the WWE. We've always wanted longer storylines and more intricate, detailed storytelling. The WWE's always been criticized for not doing that. So here, I won't kill them for this. It's probably where they have to go with it, Andy, because they just don't seem to have they got a lot of big-time wrestling names, but they don't have a lot of stars, and certainly Roman and Brock are stars. So maybe their hands are tied.
You see them putting a call in to Cena to try to drum up some excitement for, even though to wrestling fans, I think they have, I don't know if they have 2 nights worth of solid matches, but you know, I think they're going to have to call in some favors. They've let so many people go.
Well, I think that they will. I don't think he'll be part of this storyline, but I think, obviously, they got two nights at Jerry World, 100,000 perhaps max seating.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, the writing is on the wall, perhaps for like a Rock. I've even read Stone Cold. I just don't think at 53 or 54 Stone Colds, I just don't see him coming back. I mean, obviously,
maybe they'll have Hulk Hogan come back dressed as a cowboy.
Please,
I'm kidding, and get booed again. I wouldn't even want that.
So embarrassing. A big four-way for the WWE Championship. Biggie the Champ versus Seth Rollins versus Bobby Lashley versus Kevin Owens. A tough one to read here. Build-up's been meh. That's just my opinion. Andrew, you want to give a prediction on the big four-way for the WWE Championship?
Well, obviously, they're putting somebody in there to take the pin. I'm pretty sure that's probably going to be Owens. I think Owens will take the pin. As far as who's going to pin him, I probably have to go with Lashley. I think they're going to put the title back on him. They've been building him up, so I'm going to call Bobby Lashley on that one.
Interesting. I don't dislike your prediction. I'll stay with the champ, Big E. I just think that they're committed to probably trying to pump this guy up into some kind of main event match. But I like Lashley. I like this incarnation of Lashley. I really feel there's a market for a Lashley-Brock thing somewhere down the line. And hopefully, I would love it for it to happen at Mania, because I think those two guys have legit UFC background and really two big heavy hitters. So if it's not Big E, I'd love for it to be Bobby Lashley. So good job there, Andrew.
Yeah, I agree. I think the guy
to take the pin, please let me finish, is probably Kevin Owens.
I was laughing at your belch.
Oh, okay, go ahead.
I was going to ask you, do you think with Big E, you know, we were sexting yesterday, and I was getting very excited. When we were talking yesterday, I feel like Big E was thrust in a little bit too soon. He went right from the booty-os to the championship. I think he needs a mountain to climb, and I think he and Lashley could have a nice back and forth if they did that. I think he needs a little more revving up, as it were, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. You know, I won't disagree with you, but the funny thing is, I mean, Big E's been there since 2013. So, you know, it's hard for me to – I hear you. My thing is, I don't know if he was necessarily – you know what? Andrew asked, do I have a New Year's resolution? My New Year's resolution is – we get some goddamn podcasting equipment that works.
The problem was not the podcasting stuff. It was the Zoom. My internet went down. So, you know.
Screw you, Zoom.
Yeah.
Or
fuck,
whatever.
Fuck Zoom. Let's go, Brandon.
Or whatever API. We have Cox out. Cox. who's your internet provider out in Florida?
Bluestream, it's called.
Oh Lord!
Which is like, I thought that was like an unhealthy. I thought if you have a Bluestream, you gotta go see a doctor. But evidently,
I thought Bluestream was if you wanted to get romantic with a lady and had some issues, you chew on a Bluestream. And you're ready to go in the bedroom. Yeah.
No, usually it's great. Right. It never goes down, but I guess they don't like nothing worthwhile. Well, that's their problem.
All right, let's go real quick. Becky Lynch versus Liv Morgan for the Raw Women's Championship. Day one. Give us a quick thought.
Who gives a shit? Becky Lynch.
I see.
To tell you the truth.
There you go. There's Mr.
No. No. Well, you tell me. I'm not sold on anything that's going on in the women's division right now.
I as I sent you on the text message, that's, I think they've, Becky Lynch has been, I've loved her character since she's returned. Liv Morgan's been with them for a long time. She's played the, like, the young ingenue getting a crack at the, at the, at the, you know, at the top. I think she's played it well. They did one, they had one match that Becky won by, like, a little bit of a cheating kind of thing. So I think if there's an opportunity to take the belt off of Becky, which I find it hard to believe, this would be the opportunity with Liv. I don't, obviously don't think Liv Morgan's going to be a long-term solution as a champion, but if they wanted to give this young girl a taste and see how she does on the top, I think the time is now. I can't see Becky losing, but if there's an opportunity, I could see Liv Morgan taking the belt at day one and maybe for a short-term sort of push to see how she does.
So I'll go with that.
I think Becky Lynch has done really good work since she's come back, played sort of that cocky British pampered.
I liked it,
Spice Girl,
but they didn't really run with it because the crowd wasn't responding. They still like her. But in any case, I'm going to agree with your prediction. I'm going to go Liv Tyler. No, Liv who?
Liv Morgan. Liv Tyler. That's the girl from. And I don't want to lose it.
That's Steven Tyler's daughter, Liv Morgan. I'm going to go with Liv Morgan, and then I'm going to make a bold prediction that Liv Morgan's going to win here, and Becky Lynch wins the Women's Royal Rumble. For the shot.
Interesting. All right, let's hold. Then let's do one more. We'll do one more for day one. RKO Bro versus the Street Profits for the Raw Tag Team Championships.
I think here is where they will start the breakup angle for RK Bro. I wish they wouldn't because I think it's great. But I think what will happen is something like Riddle will somehow cost them the titles, and then Orton will turn. So I'm going to call who they. It doesn't even matter who they're wrestling. Who they're fighting.
Oh, come on, Street Profits are the Street Profits. Yeah, they're good.
The Street Profits will win. I'm calling Street Profits to win the titles.
Yeah, like I said on the text message, Matt Riddle, I like him. I very talented. It's too much.
Well,
too much with the stony, but stony.
But that's the thing. Listen to this. Hear me out. Hear me out.
Hold on. Let me finish my point, please. Randy Orton's done I think Orton's done some of his best work because he's kind of moved away from that wooden viper personality, yes, and he's mixed it up a little bit. So Orton has actually won me over a little bit more.
Yes.
I like Riddle. I just think I don't mind the occasional marijuana reference and he's a goofy. I don't mind it. It's become a caricature. Like every sentence has got to have a little.
I'll give you that. If I'm booking this right now, the obvious way to go would be exactly what I said. Riddle does something stupid to cost them the titles. Orton gets pissed. Orton turns on him, heel, and then they have a match either at Fastlane or maybe even WrestleMania. I mean, I think this would be deserving of that. However, if I were booking it, I'd go the opposite way, and I'd have Orton do something stupid. I'd have Riddle sort of – I'd have Orton – just when Orton's starting to embrace this nonsense, I'd have Riddle turn on him, and Riddle be the heel, and Riddle reveal that this is the real guy. He's a real badass, and he used Orton to get himself into the main event picture. I love that idea. That would be, people wouldn't see it coming. They wouldn't, you know, like it would be fresh. It'd be something interesting. And it would put Orton back into like babyface mode, which I think he'd be really good at. And I'd love to see Riddle as a nasty heel. I think it'd be fun. What do you think?
Coming. I felt like I'm listening to Gruthius Vince Russo.
bro. Yeah, listen, bro.
I mean, yeah, sure. I mean, obviously, the problem is you're going to see this storyline from a million miles away. Obviously, they're angling for there's going to be the big breakup and the big match at WrestleMania. And I agree with you. Perhaps there's other areas to mine with this tag team. And certainly tag teams in the late, in 2020 is not a main push, so to speak. So it'd be nice to give, you know, when they give a tag team sort of a main event kind of look and storyline, you know, on the show, on the shows. So sure, your idea is a good one. We could see it. Again, we could see it from a million miles away, but if they do it well, I won't mind it. How about
right.
that?
There you go. Good. Good.
All right.
There's one more we forgot. We forgot. A big one.
What is that?
Miz and Edge.
Oh, you're right. I don't know why. Of course, we can't forget our boyfriend.
Yeah. Well, let's.
All right.
Our
well,
two. I mean, these. This is. This is like. This is tough for us. This
oh,
is.
Yeah.
This is Daniel and Johnny right here. Who do we root for? We love them both more than you know.
Yeah. Well, I have. Without being goofy, I have a definitive thought on it. You're
Go
probably
ahead.
Not going to like my thought.
I
have to confront Andrew for a Miz intervention, and Andrew needs to understand, despite his pining. And Andrew is a legit fan, and it's nice because I don't think Andrew has bought into some of the current stuff like maybe I have as a fan, or, you know, I think he does follow it a little bit more since we've gotten into these WrestleMania trips, and we'll talk about that one, this wonderful trip as we get closer. The Miz, this last run as transitional champion did it for me. Like, this is it. The Miz is going to be a B+, but that's where he ends. That's, you know, and he's going to, and by the way, there is absolutely no shame in that
Nothing
whatsoever.
At all.
Miz is probably the greatest utility guy. Him and Dolph Ziggler on the WWE roster. You could put him as a comedy act. He could go serious. He can cut a promo. His ring work is still very solid. He could go with Finn Balor and Seth Rollins, and he could brawl with the Bobby Lashley. But I think ultimately his role is going to be to pump up Edge into whatever, you know, big match for WrestleMania. So I would be very surprised. I wouldn't be shocked, but I'd be very surprised if The Miz somehow goes over or goes over clean on Edge. I mean, obviously, Edge is the money guy. They're going to look to book him in a big match come Mania time. So that's how
Wait,
I see
you
it.
Just said you think Miz is going to go over on Edge. I don't think that's
No,
what
I didn't.
Is.
I said I'd be very surprised.
Oh, you'd be very surprised. All right. Yeah, okay.
Very surprised.
Yeah.
Very surprised.
I am going to say I'm going to agree with you. That I will be very surprised if that happens, but I'm still going to predict that it's going to happen because I think they can get more mileage. Because if Edge wins here, then the feud is over, and I think they can get some more mileage out of it. So I think
okay.
that doesn't. It'll be a schmoz. It'll be a Maurice will do something. It won't be a clean. It won't be a clean win for Miz, but I'm going to predict the heel victory for Miz.
I don't want to play out this wrestling conversation, but I did want to say, as I was listening to your comments, Monday Night Raw, that wedding, again, you could see it from a million miles away, but I want to just note Maurice was phenomenal.
Yep.
Crying. I thought those were real tears,
yep.
real emotionality. And boy, did Eric Bischoff set it up great when they said, I do. And then Bischoff is like, does anyone, well, right before they say, I do. And he says, would anyone want to object? And he looks at the camera
yeah.
and says something like, well, we haven't seen this coming, you know.
yeah, that was great.
Every wrestling wedding, you know, and all of a sudden you hear Edge's music and the place went bazooka.
Yeah, I loved how Miz tripped in the ring and he went with it.
Yeah, he did a McMahon flop, which is great.
I don't think that was planned. I think he legitimately tripped.
Okay. Wait, okay. Thank you, Andrew. Do you want to go into the 21st minute mark when Rocky looks at the crowd? And by the way, Marie was like, "God, you're so hard on Groot." I was working out and listening to our podcast, and I go, "There's a little backstory there." I make fun of these Rocky nerd podcasts. That,
yeah.
All right, Groot, cue it up. Let's move on. Let's get to four things we are talking about this week. It's nothing worthwhile. The week that was. Grew, the week that was is brought to you by NyYou Life Center. No goal is too big. Groo, look, you know, we could check them out at their website, www.newlifecenters.com. Actually, Andrew, I am on their website right now.
You
let's
are?
Let's take a look at... Yeah, let's take a look at this. There's the website. It's one to remember. Give me the cue. And this is the One to Grow On segment. Groo, you would not be... Groo, are you familiar with Steve Harvey?
Yes. He's the guy, the Family Feud host, right? Comedian?
Yeah, so, you know, he hosts the Miss Universe pageant every year.
Right.
And he's become famous for making miscues. So,
yeah.
This is going back 2 weeks ago because I was sick with the flu. But after announcing Miss South Africa as the second runner-up on last Sunday's 70th Miss Universe competition, Harvey turned his attention to the two remaining contestants representing Paraguay and India, respectively. Congratulations, Portugal, Harvey said before catching himself and correcting his mistake. They wrote Portugal on the damn sign, trying to play me. They're trying to get me again, but I'm not going for it this year, Harvey stated. Congratulations, Paraguay. They had Portugal on the damn sign. I looked dead at it. You all saw it. Don't try to blame me on this one this year. However, that wasn't the only moment of controversy from Harvey, as viewers took exception to his question for the eventual winner in Miss India, Harnaz Sandhu. You got to take a look at this woman. She is absolutely stunning. While other contestants were asked about their accomplishments, their political views, their this, their that, Sandhu was asked to make an animal impression. I hear you do some pretty good animal impressions. Let me hear your best one, Harvey said, much to Sandhu's surprise. Oh my God, Steve, I was not expecting to do this on the world stage, she replied, before going on to let out some impressive meows. Groo, we're going to roll tape to see Steve Harvey asking an insanely beautiful woman to make animal noises. Here we go. Oh, share sound. And here we go.
Question. Let's hear your best one.
Oh my God, Steve, I was not expecting to do this on world stage.
She's
brace
hot.
Yourself, everyone.
That is hot. Ooh.
Can we pause? Can we, I need about 45 seconds. I'll be right back. That was arousing.
any thoughts about asking the eventual Miss Universe winner to do animal impersonations, Andrew?
I'll ask her a lot of things. I don't know if animal impressions is top on the list, but did she win? So she won.
Yeah, Miss India won. Beautiful woman.
Gorgeous. Yes, but I'm sure she's very bright too. We must say that.
Yes, we must. Yes. Okay. Let me just open. I'm setting up.
So now the Steve Harvey thing is a bit. Now it's going to be that every year because of that screw up from a few years ago.
Yeah, he's a guy that's he's been known to make.
No, I know that. I'm just saying it looks like now they're going to be doing it on purpose. Just to draw attention.
Do you watch him at all on like Family Feud?
No.
I don't really watch.
No, but I never.
Actually, I was thinking about it this morning. The best part of like when you work for a school district and then you have off, I remember I was so excited when I was a kid, like in school, like elementary school and middle school, when I had off, I got to watch like morning television.
I used to watch The Price is Right.
Yeah, like all the daytime game shows. Now I'm like,
and then a big box of tissues for Days of Our Lives at one, and then
there you go.
I was
a General Hospital at 3:00.
Ah, Luke and Laura. Yes, of course.
Yeah.
I'm not into. It's funny because I'm not into when these comedians or when these TV or movie stars they find an easy game show gig. And they run with it like Drew Carey doing, you know, I loved Drew Carey on The Drew Carey Show, and he's a great stand-up comedian, but not as Bob Barker on The Price is Right. Steve Harvey, same thing. What I keep forgetting is that that's where all of these hosts came from, even way back when. Richard Dawson, Family Feud, he was on Hogan's Heroes, he was an actor. So, you know, I guess, but I, for some reason, I just have no interest in watching these guys.
Yeah, I hear you. I think it's, I mean, it's, my perception is it's an easy gig. It doesn't really stretch them creatively or artistically. And perhaps, you know, I don't know. Maybe it's a money.
And they make a fortune. And so God bless them. God bless them. They make a fortune. Howie Mandel never needs to work again in his life because of Deal or No Deal. You know? So God bless
them. Yes, God. Yeah, God bless. God bless Howie Mandel. Groo, let's get your thoughts on this. Singer Billie Eilish closed her latest album with a track called Male Fantasy. The song is about the singer's distaste for the porn industry. Eilish really recently talked about why she feels this way, why she feels this way about pornography during an appearance on the Howard Stern show. Eilish talked about her early experiences with porn. She said it, quote, destroyed her mind as a woman, quote, I think porn is a disgrace. I used to watch a lot of porn, to be honest. I started watching porn when I was like 11. I really think it destroyed my brain, and I feel incredibly devastated that I was exposed to so much porn. Eilish said she became angry that porn is so loved. She says it gave her an unrealistic idea about what her body should look like. Groo, here is a taste of Eilish's latest track, Male Fantasy. And blah, 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 look at me.
So this is an anti-porn song, and you're playing it on our podcast? This is heresy. Meanwhile, she sounds like she's mid-orgasm.
I hate the way she looks at me.
Oh, I hate porn.
I can't stand the dialogue.
No, I think this is not a terrible song. I mean, besides the actual.
Yeah, you're one flop album away from having to do porn. What's her name again?
Billie Eilish. You've heard of her.
Billie Idol? That doesn't look like Billie Idol.
No, Billie Eilish.
Billie Eilish. What would I know of her? What would I know of her?
All joking aside, Eilish is happier than ever. Was named.
Yay! I'm so excited for her.
The record received. I have to work through this, everybody. The record received Grammy nomination for Album of the Year and Best Pop Vocal Album. She recently pulled double duty.
Duty.
Recently, as host and musical guest on Saturday Night Live, which I saw a little bit of it, and she wasn't bad. I'll try to be somewhat of a serious conversation. Groo, Eilish onto something about her thoughts on pornography?
No, pornography is, and I say this with all seriousness, what the hell is wrong with pornography? Nothing. You don't teach it in a classroom, but it's an industry.
You don't think there's some truth to her saying she watched porn at the age of 11, and that messed her up, like you, like 11 years old. I mean, come on! Like, if you're
you want to know something, you want to know something. I'll be serious about this.
If you want to be serious about it,
yes, I'm going to be serious about this. Everything that I agree. Not everybody was raised the way you and I were, okay. But okay, there were many things that were off limits in my house. I was not able to watch certain things. My parents were very vigilant about it, and I guess I can't say that my watching of Rambo or this or the or MTV or whatever it hasn't hurt me in any way. And I give the credit to my parents who decided this is how we're going to raise him, and we are going to make sure that we know what he's watching, and if we don't approve, it's not going to happen. So whoever's letting an 11-year-old watch porn, okay, now I don't know how Billie Eilish was raised, but whoever's letting an 11-year-old watch porn, I think they have some, they got to look in the mirror there. So I'm not buying, I hate that fucking argument. Take some responsibility.
Okay.
Wait a second. Don't hate the industry for your reaction to it. Okay, just because you had a bad experience doesn't mean the entire fucking industry has to go down the toilet. You know how many hundreds of millions of dollars are generated by the porn industry? And I know I'm sounding like Larry Flynn here, but I'm not. I'm being serious. I don't even, I mean, for all our talk, I don't even look at porn. Okay, I wish I did, but who's got that kind of energy anymore? But the point is, it's a multi-million dollar industry, and just because you watched it when you were 11 years old and it fucked you up, end it. Goodbye. Go back to selling fireworks on the corner of Ives Dairy in 95. For Christ's sake, I hate that. I don't like
her. God bless America.
Am I making any sense to you?
Of course not. First of all, you have to remember.
That was a stupid question.
Billie Eilish is in her 20s. You're in your 40s. I'm in my early 50s. I think porn. I'm going to be serious for a second, and then we could joke through it. But to be serious. Pornography is much different today than it was when we were kids. It could be excessively violent. It could be excessively demeaning to women. It could be even excessively racist. Again, I hear what you're saying. And look, I mean, do I need yet again? Like, I just saw, for example, Angie's not going to know this, and this upset me, got me angry a little bit, but this singer who actually sang, I think, God Bless America at WrestleMania last year, Bebe Rexha. It's not somebody that Andy and I would know or listen to. She's in her 30s. She went on Instagram and she said, I'm so disgusting right now. I've gained so much weight. And I'm saying to myself, but you're putting it on Instagram. If you're heavy, keep it to yourself and, you know, a diet. And so I hear what you're saying, like another sort of young person going on social media and blaming and woe is me. I don't perhaps disagree with you there. However, you know, I do think, you know, if you're 11 years old, and I don't disagree with your point about parents, but we can't always speak to everyone's upbringing. 11 years old, that does mess kids up if they're seeing this kind of highly sexualized, perhaps highly violent imagery. It's not a good thing for a young kid. As a guy that's seen his fair share of that stuff, it's better, a better scenario if you're older and you can sort of make up your mind and have a little bit more of a fully developed brain and view of the world. I hear what you're saying, because I
agree 100% with you, though.
I love ripping these celebrities who have holier than thou and, you know, blame this and blame that. Beyond a dig on the pornography industry, I think she has a fairly valid point. 11 years old watching this stuff.
That's the only point that's valid. And that's the same point you're making. If an 11-year-old is watching a snuff film, yes, that's going to mess them up. Okay? And if they're going to do it habitually, it's going to be even worse. But at the, I don't care enough. Well, that sounds bad, but I don't care.
I hear what you're saying.
I don't care enough to look into Billie Eilish. Let me ask you a question, because I didn't listen to it.
Let me ask you a question. Is that because you don't care for Billie Eilish, or I don't know her either, and I don't really follow her music? However,
it's got nothing to do with Billie Eilish.
You hate a new young pop star.
No, whatever. Got nothing to do with that. It's got everything to do with what you said. I can't stand everybody pointing fingers at other people. Okay, take some fucking responsibility. All right. I mean, what I was going to say is I don't care enough to go into Billie Eilish's upbringing and to do a fucking investigation as to why her parents or whoever.
I don't disagree with you.
But let me ask you a question. Obviously, you listened to it. I didn't.
I didn't hear the interview.
Okay. Because I would love to hear Howard's response, because we know Howard loves porn. So I want to hear his response to that.
I could tell you probably without even hearing the interview what his response is.
What do you think?
He's going to either not comment or he's going to agree with her, because look, I'm not here to do. Yeah. I don't want to do a pornography debate. I believe she has legitimate thoughts on it, and in terms of her music, I don't know too much of it. And blah, 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 blah. Although I thought I did laugh at a couple of things she did on SNL. All right, look, the next item is this is another one that's going to probably upset me or upset you. But look, Groo, basically this item is talking about Lady Gaga. She was in this new movie, House of Gucci, which absolutely got ripped to shreds by the critics. I think they're calling it like the biggest bomb of the year. But she was so devoted and did this extreme method acting that she actually had to have a psychiatric nurse on set during the end of the filming. Quote, I sort of felt like I had to. I felt that it was safer for me, the 35-year-old told Variety. That's because I was Patricia, I think, Gucci. I always spoke in my accent, and even if I was speaking about things that weren't related to the movie, I was still living my life like her. I just lived it as I was her. Groo Gaga portrayed the chaotic life of Reggiani, the infamous wife to fashion mogul Maurizio Gucci, who was played by Adam Driver. But the darkness of the life of her character, who apparently ordered her husband's assassination in 1995, also meant that she brought the darkness home with her. Quote, I don't think that any actor should push themselves to that kind of limit, she said in an interview. And I ask myself all the time why I do that. I've done some pretty extreme art pieces throughout my career. That is true. Things I put my body through in my mind. It's like a walnut of sadness in my stomach. Groo, despite giving it her all, which also earned her a Golden Globe and a Critics' Choice nomination, the movie has sparked controversy. The family, the Gucci family, has apparently smeared the film in a statement released shortly after its premiere, calling it, quote, an insult to the legacy on which the brand is built today. Like I said, the movie was actually absolutely torched by critics. But I just wanted to ask you, we've talked about this briefly from time to time, this notion of extreme method acting. You know, what's going on here?
Well, I didn't see the movie. I heard it sucked, and I have no interest in seeing it. I wouldn't call myself a Lady Gaga fan because, but I know she's good. Like, she is a talented woman. At the same time, yes, there are certain levels that certain lengths that people go to for these method things, some more than others. I'm guessing she probably got it from, and I'm going to be a little bit of a snob here. I'm guessing she probably got her methodness from working with Bradley Cooper, because Cooper's very heavily into that because he comes from the Actors Studio, which is, you know, the famous studio in New York City where Al Pacino, Marlon Brando, and De Niro and Harvey Keitel. That's kind of why I know a little bit more about it. And yes, these people do get very heavy on the method, and it works for them. And if it gets them to where they need to be, I don't buy the idea of having a psychiatrist there to make sure you don't go crazy. I think she's probably twisting that around because they do have these people on set, like dialect coaches or people to help you get in touch with the character. These people do hire their own people for that. So that's what this sounds like. This sounds like someone who is like guiding her, like a specialist who's like guiding her, like forcing her to get in touch with whatever emotions this character is speaking. But it's not like there's a shrink waiting in her trailer when she gets back saying, all right, so what are your thoughts about that? I've never seen that, but I've seen the method stuff, and I get it. It's annoying for everybody else who's working on the movie, but at the end, it's their name that's above the title, and they got to sell the movie, and if it flops, they're the ones who suffer the most. So, you know, I've seen it, and it is what it is. Everybody has their own way of working. Well, hey, this was your story.
I was extreme method acting there. Hold on, I have a nurse.
Wait, I'll do it. I'll do it. So, what are your thoughts about getting in touch with that angry Jew from Oceanside?
Yeah, I mean, I can't believe how you just ripped Billie Eilish, but there you're like, Lady Gaga. I mean, Listen.
No. Wait. Hold on. There was one other thing I wanted to say.
Psychiatric nurse, like I said,
I think she's embellishing. I said that. I think she's embellishing. I don't think that that's what it was. Because I've never seen that. I have seen the other.
Well, go ahead. Make your point.
But at the same time, why does she need the rest of us to know this? That's my point. Like, shut the fuck up and act, you know, or do whatever you got to do. We don't need to hear how much you suffer to entertain us.
Yeah,
you know, let me ask you a question.
What do you think about these actors that, like, for example, what's the guy who was Christian Bale? Like, when they lose a shit ton of weight, almost into like an unhealthy level, is that like? What do you think about that? Is that like a cool commitment to art kind of thing?
At the same time, it probably has long term effects. Not the smartest thing to do, but if you're committed, you're committed. It's kind of the same, you know. It's similar to getting into shape or getting into certain physical condition if you're an athlete or something.
Well, you have to remember when we did the podcast about breast implants, I got breast implants.
Yes, and, you know, you have to put yourself into the right frame of mind. But I don't like when they do it because it somehow, you might hate me for this, but it seems to send a wrong message, you know.
First of all, I don't hate you, number one, for any of your takes. May not agree with it. But what's the message though? Let's get to this. I want to move on.
The message to me is put it all on the line to do your job right. Well, if it requires me to put my health in danger to be a certain kind of teacher, guess what? I'm finding a new career. I don't like how often that they're made to do it. Makeup and effects are incredible today. You know, use them. Don't put yourself in any kind of danger. There are actors and actresses who have died or have gotten very sick from something like that. Raul Julia comes to mind. Do you remember him?
Yes.
Yeah, that happened to him. He lost a ton of weight for this. I forgot what role he was playing, and it killed him. But you know, I admire it. I just think it's why be unhealthy.
Yes, everyone, stay tuned. It's a very special, nothing worthwhile, Raul Julia episode. Well, here's my thing. I appreciate excellence, and I appreciate a commitment to any endeavor. But yeah, you don't have to. I mean, well, you have to toot your own horn. Get off Variety and go sing another duet with Beyonce. All right, thank you. Grew post flu. I saw it last Tuesday that Kim Kardashian is catching heat from countless social media users after posting spoilers from the new mega hit Spider-Man movie, No Way Home. The former Keeping Up with the Kardashians star, 41 years old, watched the third Marvel blockbuster starring Tom Holland and Zendaya in what appeared to be her home theater on last Monday. When she got to the end of the film, Kardashian began taking photos of the screen, still shots, sharing them to her Instagram story, revealing to her, quote, 273 million followers that former Spider-Man actors Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield made surprise appearances alongside Holland in the new Spider-Man movie. The reality star apparently realized her mistake as she deleted the two posts shortly after uploading them, but it was already too late. Quote, I've never hated someone so much. I've muted everything Spider-Man related to my socials, man, to avoid spoilers since I'm watching it tomorrow. Quote, just for Kim Kardashian to post a whole effing spoiler on her IG, another person tweeted. I'm so livid right now. Nothing says privilege like getting a movie in your own private theater and spoiling it for those of us who are trying to stay home and stay safe. That was at least Grew. It's quoted that Kardashian's second time seeing the box office hit, as she previously watched it at a regular Staten Island theater with her new flame, Pete Davidson of SNL fame. Groo, Spider-Man No Way Home just became the first pandemic-era movie to make over $1 billion globally, pulling in an estimated $81.5 million over the Christmas time weekend alone. Groo, who gives a shit? Who gives a fuck? Floor is yours.
Agreed. She didn't do anything that
If I may step in, actually, if I could just step in, because my thing is, of course that's completely obnoxious of what Kim Kardashian is doing, but the fans are even more obnoxious.
Yes!
So now, privilege, and I deleted my socials. It's just like, wow, everybody's just...
Hang on, but...
Everybody is just...
Yeah, but here's the thing. Look, listen, I think Kim Kardashian is the epitome of everything that needs to be fixed in America because of stories like this. Kim Kardashian posts something on Instagram, world loses its fucking mind. That's dangerous to idolize somebody on that level. At the same time, I saw Spider-Man. I saw it, I think, the day after it came out. I've known about all this crap for weeks, and so has everybody else. So whoever's bitching and moaning about spoilers is full of shit because it's all been out there, and it wasn't even good. So who cares? But everybody cares because it's like the biggest movie ever. It wasn't bad. It just wasn't. I'm not saying anything.
Flavor.
I'm saying we can do a podcast on it later on. I'd be interested. Again, with the Kardashian thing, it's much ado about nothing. Who gives a shit? Grow up. Everybody grow up. Okay? Oh, my God. You want to kill yourself because they spoiled a movie for you. Ooh, fuck. God. Take a tampon out. No, you piss me off now.
Well, I'm sorry.
No, I mean, the story. It's just like, this is news.
Well, the thing is, I want to be mad at Kim Kardashian, but everybody else is so way over the top that I feel like, you know what?
I agree with you. It's nuts.
Two stupid still shots on her Instagram. And like you said, I mean, pretty much now, even with the trailers, there's 15 different trailers for Spider-Man focusing on this. They give away
everything. Everybody knew everything.
All right, just talk over
the real story. The real story is
we've been on for an hour and a half. We haven't even talked one thing about Brad Midland and the Grateful Dead.
But the real story is there that Pete Davidson must have a cock as big as Staten Island, because Pete Davidson, Kim Kardashian, who did he just break up with?
I don't know, but I will tell you this much:
he gets the hottest women. And that other yo-yo on Saturday Night Live is with Scarlett Jameson, Jones, whatever her name is. It's too long a name. And what's the guy on Saturday? What's the guy on Saturday Night Live?
What are you ranting about? What do you mean the guy on who are you talking about?
The Weekend Update guy, Colin Jost.
Colin, I know who you're talking about.
Colin Johnson, whatever his name is. He isn't
Colin
he,
Jost. Don't make it like you don't know.
Isn't he like married to Scarlett, whatever her name is?
You see, he's trying to be funny right
now. I'm not trying to do anything.
It's Scarlett Johansson. You know the lady. You've seen her in enough movies. Yes, I think they're married. Yes. Now, to your point about Pete Davidson having a big, you know what, I will never kiss and tell. See, I had that joke in my head, and then he just talked. He was ranting, you know, ranting about Pete Davidson. And anyway,
no, I want to go on Saturday Night Live. For Christ's sake.
Yeah, well, we should. All right, let's move on, Andrew. Today's Nothing Worthwhile podcast. Brett Midland and the Dead. Midland and the Dead is brought to you by NyYou Life Center. NyYou Life Center is growing. Marie, we just saw on the screen, she's excited to announce that they've moved to a new location. Check them out in Phoenix, 4515 North 16th Street. That's Suite 105. Again, Phoenix, Arizona, 85016. Give Marie a call at 602-274-0068. Check out their website. I'm on there. You want to check out Evan Moody on the New You Life Center website, www.newyoulifecenters.com. Begin a new you, life-changing solutions tailored to your goals. All right, Andrew Grew, when most rock groups played the same carefully rehearsed two-hour show night after night for months on end, the Grateful Dead were playing two-hour-plus sets that changed wildly from night to night. They often didn't even have a set list, choosing to simply walk on stage and see where the music took them. Grew, Jerry Garcia has been dead for over, I think, for nearly 20 years, but the surviving members have played together in various permutations ever since. We haven't discussed the Dead too much, a little bit from time to time on our various podcasts, but we'll throw it to you, Andrew. Feel free to opine on the Grateful Dead. Now, what I am curious about is, I thought about this, you know, the Andrew Groothius that I know. By the way, what are you doing right now? I'm trying to have a conversation.
I'm trying to fix something. I'm sorry.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Hey, relax. Take it easy.
God damn it.
I'm listening.
You know, that's what I'm going to do. When Andrew's ranting, I'm going to go walk over and heat up my rice, my chicken and rice.
Oh. No, you were going to ask me.
I know, but you were busy changing the oil on your...
No, I'm making sure that this thing...
On your Toyota.
No, we do a live show here. We got to make sure it. I got to make sure it's working.
All right, well, cut the blue wire.
They're both blue wires.
Exactly. Well, I wanted to ask you, because I've always thought of Andy as a straight-up rock guy. Like, Andy likes rock and roll music. Andy likes... You know, and so do I.
That is true. 5 minute,
5 minute. You know. Let's get to it. Let's rock and roll. Yet the quote unquote greatest jam band. You've mentioned them more and more the last couple of years, and I just wanted to find out, how did the Grateful Dead come into your radar?
Well, they've always been on my radar, but I've never been a Deadhead, and I'm not a Deadhead, and I never will be. I probably can name 15 Grateful Dead songs.
Okay.
But I go back with them a little bit because I remember enjoying... I've always enjoyed the Grateful Dead. I never understood the phenomenon because, yes, there are groups that and artists that I whose songs I love way more than the Grateful Dead. But watching... them, and you know what, it's really weird, and I'm glad you asked the question, because I was actually thinking about this the other day on the toilet.
Oh,
I was thinking, if you gave me a choice,
let me allow, just, I got a funny line when you hear me talk. That's such vivid imagery, you on the toilet opining about the Grateful Dead.
Yes.
Now please go back to your thoughts.
Thank you. If you asked me if I had a choice to go see, let's say this was back in 1990, all right?
Go ahead.
If I had a chance to see the Grateful Dead or Def Leppard, I would say Def Leppard, because I know I'd have more fun at that concert. However, I can't name all the members of Def Leppard. I can't name all their albums. I can name all the members of the Grateful Dead, past and present. I know the songwriters. I know like I know so much more about the Grateful Dead. I guess my fascination with them goes beyond their music. I've watched both documentaries, the Long Strange Trip, which I think was on Amazon, and then the one about Bob Weir, which was called The Other One. They're a fascinating band.
That was on Netflix, I believe.
Okay, right? One was on Amazon, one was on Netflix. But either way,
I've seen both. Yeah.
Yeah, and to me, they're just it's beyond the music. It's they're a fascinating band. They're like, I remember an interview with Springsteen once. He called his E Street Band a glorified bar band, and I couldn't disagree with me. Couldn't disagree more. The Grateful Dead are a glorified bar band. You sit there and watch them play at Giant Stadium on a YouTube clip, and they might as well be playing at Lefty's Bar and Grill around the corner. Like, that's the kind of band that they are. And that's what I like about them. They're just fascinating to watch how the music...
Yeah.
It's not even the fans. It's just I enjoy the band. It's strange. It's strange. And for this podcast, I was watching a lot of older stuff, and I found myself like, man, this is good shit. You know?
Well, listening to your comments, I'll take a slight disagree. I hear what you're saying, you know, whatever, they could be playing Lefty's Bar and Grill, but no, I think the E Street Band actually is the ultimate bar band, and I think the Dead, it encompasses so much more. I mean, the Dead, you know, if you're looking at them musically, it's really various styles, various improvisation, you know, jazz, funk, percussions, you know, they can kind of do it all and do it well enough to satisfy their fan base. Whereas I think the Ishii Band really was the ultimate bar band that they're going to play for the most part straightforward, for the most part straightforward rock and roll. You know, listening to your comments, you know, the Dead really kind of did social media before social media came into existence. I mean, the Dead had
is that the ticket thing?
Really, like underground fan base. They had what's the word? like fanzines and underground, like, you know, pamphlets and things, you know, literature promoting the band. And I remember even
they have like ways of getting tickets.
Yeah, well, that was that in itself. I remember it was like my friends. We would go to like somebody's house. Like, let's say we go to my house, me and two or three of my friends, like Jeff Yesner, you know, a couple of kids from Oceanside, and it was such specific group. I mean, it was such specific. You had to get, you know, 8.5 by 11 paper folded three times into you know, this envelope, self-addressed envelope, a money order for X number, you know, and it was always. Like very fun in a sense.
It was
the
fun.
The band where we going to get in, and you know, and so so to reference, you know, I mean, obviously growing up in Oceanside was a big Grateful Dead town, and you know, I came on board probably late high school, you know, 10th grade, 11th grade when the Dead came on my radar, and obviously if you're referencing Brett Midland, you know, that run of Brett Midland when he was in his heyday. That's when I became a massive, massive fan. So the Brent Midland era for the Grateful Dead is always, you know, somewhat interesting to talk about for me. So, Groo, who is Brent Midland? He's an American keyboardist, vocalist, and songwriter. He was a member of the Grateful Dead from 1979 to 1990, and a longer tenure than any other keyboardist in the band, which did surprise me a little bit when you think about it. The Grateful Dead have somewhat of a Spinal Tap-ish relationship with their keyboardists. They've gone through a few of them, that's for sure.
They're all dead.
It did surprise me a little bit when I, you know, and I read that Brent Midland, of all folks, had the longest tenure in terms of keyboard, you know, piano in terms of the Grateful Dead.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, he went from 79 to 90, which was, he didn't leave the band, he died, but if you think about it, the Dead really started in like the late 60s.
Yes.
And you had Ron, you had Pigpen, and then yes. Keith Godshow, who basically went from like late 60s to mid to late 70s. And then you have two of those guys. Pigpen, I think he died after he left the band, I think, and so did Godshow. It didn't surprise me, just because I knew about those guys, that Midland was the longest because he basically had the whole 80s.
Yeah. Midland grew up in Concord, California. After graduating high school, Midland played with a number of bands and recorded one album with the band Silver just before joining Bobby and the Midnights. Groo, here is a taste of pre-Dead Midland. It's Ooh. Silver with Wham Bam Shang-a-Lang.
I've never heard anything of Midland that's not Grateful Dead. I can't wait to hear this. There we go. We got a love. Is
it a love to stay? There's Brent. I see him. Come on, here we go. We got a Wham Bam
Shang-a-Lang.
Come on, Brad. There's Brent Midland right here.
Yeah. Interesting. You can hear the cocaine going in and out.
Well, I know that this song was on the Guardians of the Galaxy 2 soundtrack. So I don't know. Silver, Wham Bam Shang-a-Lang.
Yeah, never heard of the group, never heard of the song, but it's interesting. It's interesting 60s rock. It's sort of like that Phil Spector Wallace sound kind of thing.
I think it was more 70s, but it's very middle of the road. Yeah, I think like kind of West Coast soft rocky vibe on that song.
Yeah, good stuff. I didn't hear much keyboards in there. I'm sure they were buried somewhere. Yeah. But that's fun stuff.
It's funny on the picture you see like a very clear and cogent and coherent Fred Midland.
Yeah,
that was going to be changing shortly. Yeah.
very short.
Brett Midland was born in Munich, Germany, the child of a U.S. Army chaplain. Midland moved to San Francisco with his parents at the age of one. Again, he spent most of his childhood in Concord, California. He started piano lessons at the age of six, had formal classical music lessons throughout his junior year in high school. His mother, who was a graveyard shift nurse, encouraged Brett Midland by insisting that he practice his music 2 hours each day. He also played trumpet, accordion, and piano, so he had a pretty well-rounded musical background. Again, Midland played rock and roll with his friends in high school, was influenced by keyboardist Lee Michaels, don't know him, Ray Manzarek of The Doors, we certainly know him, and Steppenwolf's Goldie McJohn. It sounds like the new wrestler on WWE NXT. Goldie McJohn! One fall to the finish. And apparently Midland was indeed a fan of the Grateful Dead in the late 60s. After high school graduation, Groo, he moved to Thousand Oaks, California, and lived in what's called a Quonset hut. Do you know what a Quonset hut is?
No. But I think all we need to know is hut and to know what kind of guy he was.
What the fudge?
What happened? What's the matter? Hold on. What's the matter? What's the matter, Boogie?
Quonset hunt.
Quions.
You see this? This is a Quonset hunt.
It's a little barn.
Yeah, you know? I mean, would you like to live in something like that?
No.
Okay, well, anyway.
Would you?
No. I just thought that'd be interesting just to see Quonset. Sounds like almost like what Riley Martin. Quonset? Lajuan. Yeah, it's a prefab structure.
So he's basically like a hippie kind of guy before the
he definitely lived that kind of lifestyle.
Right.
He joined a band with Rick Carlos, who was invited by John Batdorf of Batdorf and Rodney to join their band. Of course, you know, he played at that with that band Silver, which we just listened to a track with Batdorf. They released one album on Arista Records, and then Midland got in touch with Bobby Weir, guitarist for the Grateful Dead, who had a connection from Batdorf and Rodney, who joined Weir's side on the side project Bobby and the Midnights as a keyboardist and backing vocals. Midland finally joined the Grateful Dead in April of 1979, as you said, replacing Keith and Donna Godcho.
Donna was she was a singer, right? She was like a backup singer.
Yeah, she did background vocals.
Right. Okay.
So Keith and Donna Godcho left the Grateful Dead to start their own band, and after just 2 weeks of rehearsals, he played his first concert with the band. Meeting Brett Midland at Spartan Stadium in San Jose, California on April 22nd, 1979. Groo, here's a taste of Brett Midland's first show at the Grateful Dead, a bit of Shakedown Street.
Oh, my favorite.
Oh, here we go. This should be right here.
Used to be the heart of town. Yeah, this is a great song. See, I can hear the. I'll wait.
Oh, yes.
I'm so fucked up.
Oh, we got a little of a chorus break here. Well, anyway.
I'm a mess. I'm a mess. Because, you know, well, first of all, you can hear. See, I was looking at the different keyboardists, and when I'm watching Pigpen, you know, I was going all over YouTube the last few days, and when I'm listening to songs with Pigpen and when I'm listening to songs with God's Show, I'm hearing the keyboard as kind of a true rhythm instrument, meaning it's just playing the chords. I might be discrediting them a little bit, but for some reason, when Brent was with them, the keys become a lead instrument, just like Jerry's guitar. That's what I'm hearing. I can hear and feel the notes that he's playing with that. But it's strange because, like you brought up before, I've never been into this kind of music. I'm not a jam band kind of guy. You know, I saw the Grateful Dead 3 times. It was after Brent had died, but I remember 2 of those shows I really didn't like, but 1 I loved. They were 3 in a row at Nassau Coliseum. But I'm sitting here watching this stuff and listening to this stuff. I'm like, this stuff is fucking great, meaning now. But then I switch over. Maybe you could help me with this. But then I switch over. I said, okay, let me test my theory here. So then I started watching some Dave Matthews. As you know, the Dave Matthews Band and I have a long and very bad relationship.
You're not a fan.
I never got it. I've always disliked it. And I'm watching it the same way I was watching this Grateful Dead stuff, and I'm hating it even more. So why am I falling back in love with the Grateful Dead, who are basically doing the same thing the Dave Matthews Band is doing? Why do I'm what am I missing? I mean, I know we're not doing the Grateful Dead here, but it just struck me last night. Like, I should be liking this, but I don't.
Okay, to your first point about Brent playing more of a lead with the keyboards, I definitely agree with you. There's a forcefulness there. I mean, this guy, if you watch any of the extended clips. And you'll even see it on one of the clips that I'll play. I mean, this guy is super into the music and really plays the instrument like a guitar in a sense.
Yeah.
He's hitting those keys heavy, and that's the kind of playing that I think Grew and I both really enjoy. Love when Billy, you know, gets wrapped up into it and, you know, really hits those keys hard.
Yeah.
To the improvisational piece, ironically enough, I'm not a huge fan of the improvisational stuff. I mean, even to the extent that, and you know this about me, back when I was a young kid, I didn't even like when Springsteen would do those long diatribes. Like, get to the music.
I agree.
That's why I'm here. Like, I don't, you know, so when they're done well with the Dead, I did enjoy them, but like, we'll talk about like Built to Last. I'm a big fan of that album because it's a standard straight ahead rock album, 5 minutes, 6 minute songs. You know, it's not wavy gravy. Now, to the comparison with Dave Matthews, I like some of Dave Matthews' stuff. I'm not a fan. I wouldn't probably go see him live. The only thing I'm thinking of is perhaps, you know, the Dead did it first. They laid the foundation for sort of that industry, you know, that Fish followed, and Dave Matthews and, you know, John Mayer to an extent, and perhaps the Dead did it first, and they did it really the best, perhaps.
Yeah.
That
makes sense. I mean, and I just enjoy watching these guys for some reason. Watching them because, like I said before, it feels like, especially when you're watching it close up on YouTube, that there are some really good quality videos of this band. And when you're watching it, you're right in it, and so you're like the jams. They don't. Like, it'd be different if you're sitting, you know, 1,000 yards away, you know, watching a 15-minute jam of Shakedown Street. But when you're basically sitting on stage, it's a whole different experience. So maybe that's
something to do. Do you feel that, like, something like Dave Matthews, it's I don't want to sound like a snob either, which I hate, but do you feel like it's inauthentic?
I don't think it's inauthentic. I just don't get it. I can't understand a word he's singing. I don't understand. It just seems like they're doing it just to do it. And everything sounds the same. Now, I used to make the same argument about the Grateful Dead. And to an extent, if I put the Grateful Dead channel on Sirius, okay, and I put it on just at any random time, like five different random times a day, most of the stuff is going to sound very similar to me. It's when you go deeper, and then you see, you know, the like Brent, like, you know, how we see. And I've asked a few people who are way more into the Dead than we are. I've asked who they consider to be the main Grateful Dead keyboardist, and they all have said Brent, which was a little fascinating to me.
Well, I agree with that, and also Billie Eilish agrees with going deeper. Thank you. Groo, as you mentioned, Brent Mydland quickly became an integral part of the Grateful Dead, you know, to his vocal and songwriting skills as much as his keyboard playing. He quickly combined his tenor singing with founding members Weir and Jerry Garcia. I always loved the way Brent and Jerry Garcia sounded together, part of a strong three-part harmony on live, you know, favorite songs. Easily fit into the band's sound and added his own contributions, such as 1980's Go to Heaven, which featured two Mydland songs. First one, Far From Me.
Oh, I love this song.
And we will give Andrew a little taste of Far From Me right now.
Have a better engine mind.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem you really have to close your eyes to see. And though I know you don't mean to be, you are so far from me.
Just look at the way he's playing those keyboards.
Yeah.
Now. I mean, it's look at that. That's
he's just so fucking talented. He's got some pipes too. I mean, he can hit those high notes.
What'd you think of that? That's his first single with the Grateful Dead.
Well,
the first, you know, album cut, Far From Me. What do you think as an introduction to the Grateful Dead world? So
well, it wasn't just an introduction to of Brent Mydland for me when I got that album. That's the first.
Okay.
That's the first Dead album that I bought, and the first song that I instantly fell in love with was that one. Yeah, I think the album opens up with Alabama Getaway, which is a good song.
Yes.
But Far From Me, I think, was number two, and when I heard that one, I'm like, this is fucking great. And I listened to the rest of the album. And I was never a Deadhead, but I remember specifically getting that album and discovering the Grateful Dead. And I really thought that Brent Mydland was the main guy. That's how little I knew about the Grateful Dead because of those great songs.
Really?
And
really?
I was 13 or 14 at the time.
Really,
yeah. So, you know, obviously as time went on, I realized exactly what the dynamic was, but... love that song, and I really love that album.
Do you think that we have clearly we'll talk about it, you know, our final thoughts, but we have an affinity for Brent Mydland because we're both guys that have grown up and, you know, enjoy artists like Billy Joel, Elton John. We like keyboarding, we like piano, you know.
I don't think so. Well, I can only speak for me because I think he's a great songwriter. And he just fit into that band so beautifully. I just see him as a complete. He's what do they call it when? I mean, he's very unique. What do they call it when someone is literally like one of a kind, an anomaly? Is that what they call it?
Yeah.
That's Brent Mydland. So I don't even think about like a Billy Joel or Elton John.
I'm clearly off base.
No. But you're asking me, and I said I could only speak for me. You tell me why you do.
I mean, I think. I just did. I mean, I've always had an affinity for, you know, keyboards, piano, and rock and roll. And Brent Mydland, I wouldn't say it's a similar style. No, absolutely not. But I think that, you know, I think that for me, that's part of the reason. And, you know, his vocals are so darn forceful.
Well, yeah.
Speaking to vocals, I think this is the first song that Brett Mydland got on my radar. This is this second album cut from,
Go to Heaven.
Go to Heaven. Thank you, Andrew. Easy to Love You.
Oh, this is a great one, too.
Great chorus.
Can't imagine what's behind those sleepy eyes.
You could see the smoke all over the place.
Well, what do you think of Easy to Love You?
Oh, that's a great song. Always has been. But I've never actually heard or seen it perform live. So it was interesting to me how he was kind of like, they can't see it at home, I'll just describe it, that, you know, he was basically on stage by himself playing that as the other band members kind of started taking the stage.
Right. Nothing worthwhile. The recognized symbol of excellence in crappy podcasting.
Hi, I'm Evan Moody, man.
Yeah, Andy Griffiths, man. What's going on?
And you're listening to Nothing Worthwhile.
And you're listening to Nothing with Groo and the thing there.
Of course, I prefer atonal jazz, but... Oh, hi. We're with Brent Mydland, the keyboard player for the Grateful Dead. Brent, I suppose you get tired of being asked what it's like to be the new member of the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, I'm getting real burned out on that.